Around 1500 years ago, massive pyramids stood in the foothills of the Andes Mountains. Kasarabe farming families moved through a web of streets, plazas, canals, and buildings. Causeways connected dozens of urban settlements. And then, around 600 years ago, they all vanished. We don't know why. Over time, a rainforest sprang up over the abandoned settlements. Trees and vines filled the canals and took over the pyramids. The rainforest flourished as if the whole civilization had never existed at all. It's hard to imagine a millennium-old civilization five times the size of New York City just gone. But the Earth is amazingly good at wiping the slate clean, and one day, it is likely to do the same with our modern world. Because one day, all humans will almost certainly be gone. Whether we do ourselves in or die out in a plague or a meteor strike or some other catastrophe. And when that happens, whatever that is, our bodies, artifacts, and cities will all return to the Earth. Forests, fire, water, and microbes will overtake and break down almost every trace of us. Our planet will move on. As it always has. But some things we have made and altered will last much longer than others, and they're probably not the things you would expect. So let's take a trip to the distant future and see what humanity will leave behind. It's hard to look at a city like New York with its towering buildings and all that concrete and steel and imagine it ever disappearing. Modern cities just seem more permanent than a web of settlements in the pre-Columbian Amazon, no matter how advanced they were. But if people suddenly abandoned New York one day, or Tokyo, or Nairobi, or any other city, it wouldn't be long before nature rushed back in. Just look at what has happened to the area around Chernobyl in just 40 years. In major cities, water would penetrate and destroy buildings, plants would pop up through roads, steel bridges would corrode, and sooner or later, wood structures would burn. Before long, forests and marshes would return. If an alien spacecraft flew over Earth thousands of years after we are gone, they'd stare down at a seemingly pristine natural landscape with few obvious signs that we were ever here. But that natural landscape wouldn't be quite as pristine as it looked, because even if the cities themselves are gone, any place we once transformed can never be quite the same again. We humans have a habit of showing up somewhere beautiful and leaving our mark. Take the Canary Islands. When the first people arrived there more than 2,000 years ago, they found a volcanic landscape covered in trees, and then they started clearing them for farming. Later on, nature returned, but not the original forest. Even today, the island is full of shrubs and herbs, but the original forest never bounced back. When humans upset the balance of an ecosystem, nature usually picks itself up and finds a new balance, instead of returning to how it used to be. That's what has happened over the last few decades in lakes all over North America ever since people accidentally introduced zebra mussels. Zebra mussels devour the plankton that other lake life depends on. Without enough food, the numbers of native mussels and clams have plummeted. Meanwhile, all the zebra mussels' waste falls to the lake bed, so the leeches and crustaceans down there are having a feast, along with a bunch of bacteria. At this point, the flow and balance of these ecosystems has completely shifted. Even if we could completely get rid of the zebra mussels, those ecosystems would never be the same. Thousands of years down the line, our fingerprint will still be there. It might not point clearly back to humans or tell alien explorers how clumsy we were, but it's a mark we have made that will always be there. Of course, some evidence of time here will be a lot more concrete, and I'm not talking about concrete itself, because most of that stuff will crumble within a few centuries. I'm talking about things like glassware and ceramics, the same kinds of objects archaeologists typically dig up at the sites of ancient civilizations today. These things last basically forever, thanks to their chemical composition. In other words, the way they are stuck together. In glass, silicon and oxygen atoms lock together with extremely strong bonds. The way they're arranged, it's really hard for any other chemicals to tear them apart. That's why natural forms of glass, like obsidian and basalt formed in volcanoes, can be millions of years old. Ceramics work differently, but they are really strong as well. In these materials, non-metal atoms steal electrons from metal atoms. This creates opposite charges that stick together like magnets. Even though both glass and ceramics shatter very easily, they never really break down chemically. Long after we are gone, broken jars and bathroom tiles will still litter the ground of former cities. Millions of years from now, future species or extraterrestrial visitors wading through forests might pick them up and wonder about the species that made all of this incredibly durable junk. These random shards wouldn't say a whole lot about who we were, let alone hint at what kinds of cities once stood in those spots, but future explorers could tell that some kind of technologically advanced society was here before. Weirdly, though, some of the most long-lasting traces of human civilization might not be from modern humanity at all. They might be from the remains of much older civilizations. Around 10 meters beneath Naples, there's an entire buried city, complete with roads, buildings, aqueducts, and burial chambers. It was built by the ancient Greeks around 2,500 years ago. Archaeologists can't access very much of it because there's a modern city parked on top of it. They can't just start digging. But over the years, people have accidentally dug into it while building things like cisterns or bomb shelters. Which, I mean, like, imagine trying to build a bomb shelter during the height of World War II and finding a 2,500-year-old city. And even though this ancient city is about a millennium older than the Kasarabe settlements buried under the Amazon, it is incredibly well preserved. Some ancient frescoes and sculptures are still intact, which goes to show that a city that's been protected from the elements can stick it out much longer than a city that is constantly facing things like rain, wind, snow, fire, and swinging temperatures. So ancient buried cities like this one could outlast many of our modern ones. That means that future explorers might completely miss modern society and just assume that humanity peaked in BCE times. Either way, imagine trying to grasp what we were all about based on ancient underground ruins and some random objects like glass shards and broken ceramics. But that might not be all they have to work with, though. But before I tell you more about that, a quick ad.
This SciShow video is supported by ACT, the college admissions test. But not the old ACT that I took back in high school. Now there's the enhanced ACT, with more time per question and more flexibility to showcase your strengths. It's the most streamlined and flexible ACT has ever been. It's shorter to help you finish faster, give you more time to think through each question, and feel less rushed. The idea is to make you feel calmer and more focused so you stay sharp from start to finish. And this enhanced ACT is equally preferred by all US colleges and designed to deliver the same trusted scores in a shorter, more flexible format. To learn more or register for the next upcoming test, scan the QR code or click the link in the description.
Today, one of the ways we can tell where ancient humans lived, even if there's no obvious trace of them, is through their mark on the planet itself. In huge stretches of Amazon, there are patches of soil that are darker than the soil surrounding them. They're called terra preta, meaning dark earth, and they get their color from high levels of an organic material called char. Char is a kind of charcoal that you get by burning things like wood, plants, or manure. It's totally natural, but these patches of rainforest did not get this way naturally. Around 9,000 years ago, it looks like people started spreading this around patches of the Amazon, most likely to make the soil more fertile. They've been gone around 1,000 years, but this trace of them is still there. These days, we are changing the soil a lot too, all over the planet. Ever since the 1950s, soil everywhere has contained little bits of debris known as spheroidal carbonaceous particles. And unlike char, these particles don't form in nature. We make them when we burn coal and oil at temperatures higher than 1,000 degrees Celsius. If future explorers analyze soil layers the way that we do, with ice or soil cores, they'll find a weird spike in these particles dating back to our era. And even if they have no idea what a human was, they will know that something artificial suddenly transformed the environment. They might guess that an industrialized species had come before them, and they might even be able to create a map of our modern societies using the concentration of particles to figure out where we were clustered. Now, all of these clues could reveal a lot about humanity, but in a way, they miss the essence of us. I mean, our stories, our music, our art, all of these intangible things that make us human, most of these will vanish with us. Maybe some artwork will survive millennia in underground or buried cities, like the ancient frescoes under Naples. But most of our art is not tucked away for safekeeping, at least not on these timescales. There is one type of art, though, that could survive almost indefinitely. The bottom of the Mediterranean Sea is littered with shipwrecks dating to ancient times, in particular, back to the Bronze Age. This was when people realized that they could mix copper with a small amount of tin to create a tougher metal. Bronze is ridiculously durable, and there are a few reasons for that. Metals like iron rust because they combine with oxygen and water around them to form that flaky brown stuff that you see on old bridges and railings. But bronze has a different chemical makeup. When the copper in bronze combines with oxygen in the environment, instead of rusting, thing. It forms a tough outer layer called a patina. It's basically an armor that protects it from corroding any further. The tin in the bronze helps too. It also forms a stable outer layer that protects it from being attacked by water. More than 5,000 years ago, people began using bronze to make weapons, art, and other goods that they ferried around the Mediterranean. Some of that stuff ended up at the bottom of the sea, which was terrible for the people at the time, but for the people of the future, it's still there. In 1902, divers pulled up a full statue of a Greek youth dating back to the 4th century BCE, still in great shape after thousands of years underwater. So long after our books and instruments and paintings are gone, future species exploring this planet might come across our bronze art. And they'd be able to see what we looked like and what we cared about. Or maybe they'll dig up ancient weapons and wonder what kind of species made both beautiful art and tools for destroying each other out of the same stuff. No matter what, our planet will reshape itself after we are gone. Given enough time, even the ceramics and glass and underground cities will become part of its ambitious recycling program. But it's nice to know that some things will definitely survive long after our chapter is over. Starting to think maybe we should make a bronze SciShow keychain. That would be the kind of thing we should have thought of like a couple of weeks ago. But we didn't.